I already mentioned the principle that that I have referenced there with Amos, Bullock, and the Establishment Clause. If you give an exemption that's too accommodating and too broad, you can run afoul of the Establishment Clause. Amos was a case involving the Mormon Church. I threw something in there to be contemporary with the election. And in Amos, a janitor was dismissed from his job at a Mormon-run gymnasium because he didn't get a temple recommend, which means he wasn't in good standing with the Mormon Church. And he was fired for that because there's an exemption in this description that excludes religious affiliation, or that allows religious organizations to discriminate on the basis of an individual's religious affiliation when dealing with the religious activities of the organization. And his argument was, what are you talking about? I'm a janitor. And if you apply it to me, that violates the Establishment Clause, is what he said. It only has to go, you can apply it to religious activities, but not to me, guy picking up towels or whatever. And the court rejects it. Justice White, for a bare majority, rejects that and says, no, we don't want to interfere with a religious organization picking who it thinks it needs to pick to advance its mission. Good case for us. But it still was close. It's a different court today. And again, it's a matter of how broad an exemption can be until we violate the Establishment Clause.
California. One thing that I will say is California had this mandated contraceptive coverage, has had it since 1999. And the exemption under California state law, and it was litigated all the way to the California Supreme Court, didn't go to the U.S. Supremes, went to the California Supreme Court, and the Supreme Court of California upheld it. And the exemption that the California statute has is identical. You all see my cousin Vinny? It's identical. It's identical to the one that HHS has used. And it was challenged on that basis by Catholic Charities of Sacramento. And the Catholic Charities of Sacramento, as I said, litigated it and they lost it. And the court, as you might expect, relied on Smith in rejecting it. This is a generally applicable law. A generally applicable law that is not targeting any particular denomination or religious practice. It is applies to all employers. I'll be back to that in a minute. I said, what about, and this is, I was hoping I initially, is the general counsel from Notre Dame here? Because I threw this, I saw that she might be, and I was going to throw this out as an idea that I had when I was coming up with this. The Affordable Health Care Act, the Affordable Care Act was upheld in a surprise decision this last, recently. And with the chief, John Roberts, writing an opinion that surprised everybody. And that has relevance to this contraception mandate. I'm just throwing this in here for interest. The reason it has relevance is, Congress has very few regulatory powers. Regulatory power as distinct from taxing power or spending power. And a regulatory power allows Congress to establish a regulation and coerce compliance by either fines, prison, or other enforcement mechanisms. Whereas a tax is just a tax, even though it clearly has a regulatory effect, it's not considered a regulatory power. And spending, ditto, you can spend with all kinds of strings attached, which where you get to have stuff done that you couldn't regulate, but it's not a regulatory power. It's taxing and it's spending. Commerce Clause, on the other hand, is a regulatory power. That's all the criminal statutes in the federal government Those are all under the commerce power. Most of all the New Deal was under the commerce power. Most regulations, the federal government, all the drug laws are pursuant to the commerce power. And Congress cites the commerce power when it comes up with the Affordable Care Act. And it gets litigated, and the court determines, five justices say, Congress has no power to regulate this area. So that's off the table. Everyone thought that as soon as five, and everyone counted correctly, myself included, those five. Dana doesn't, and Roberts was one of them. No regulatory power to do this, Congress. But John Roberts surprised a few, myself included, by saying, yeah, but you can tax. And it's not, even though it looks like a regulation, it's really not. What we're doing is saying, we're going to tax you if you don't provide, if you don't buy health insurance. We're going to tax you if you don't buy health insurance. If you buy it, you don't have the tax. If you do buy, or if you don't buy it, you get taxed $600 or whatever it is, and it gets collected on your 1040 or on your tax form. The dissent went nuts on that. Scalia wrote it, and he can go nuts in a very colorful way. He said, it sounds like a regulation. It cites all the things you must do, including the mandate to buy, and all the stuff that you would think a regulation would have, with a fine attached. They called it a fine if you didn't comply. They didn't call it a tax. All this being that when Congress gave HHS the power to promulgate rules consistent with and in enforcement of and in furtherance of the law that they thought was a regulation called the Affordable Care Act, HHS started doing that. And that's where the contraception mandate came from. Now that it's a tax only, does the HHS have the power, legitimate authority, to come up with regs on what kind of insurance coverage we should have? I don't know. The answer is I don't know. I haven't heard much discussion about that, and I'm sure that'll get litigated. So that's one, the exemption that's currently being used by states like California and by the feds is one way in which our religiosity gets determined. Another way, which John Hart's going to talk about in some detail, is the recent goings-on with the National Labor Relations Board, which adopted a very intrusive test called the Substantial Religious Character Test, where the board looked at how involved the religious organization was in running the school, and looked at your mission and at your curriculum, and made independent judgments on how religious they were, looked at your faculty hiring and made independent judgments on how religious that was, and it was actually a very intrusive test. The Circuit Court, the D.C. Circuit Court of Appeals, has come up with that test, has said that test was way too intrusive. Instead, in a case called Great Falls that John will talk about, has, and you can read the three prongs there, makes a much more lenient test. And the question that we all have now is, if we adopt this test across the board, which certainly sounds good to me, would we run afoul of the Establishment Clause? Because it would allow us to exempt ourselves from many regulations that otherwise we wouldn't be exempt from, arguably. All that is background to what I need to say now. And if you watch the Clinton during the convention, the Democratic convention, this is the part where he says, this is really important, listen to this. I said I wanted to get back to my third hat, because it has analogous, I think, implications to what we've been talking about. My third hat is a non-Jesuit, non-Catholic president in charge of the mission, the Catholic-Jesuit Marymount mission at Loyola Marymount University. How does that work? And the reason I say it's an analogous situation to what we've been talking about is I think we can get sidetracked by the hot button political issues that are fun to think and talk about and over which we like to cry foul and infringement on religious liberty and spend a little bit of too much, talking about myself, not you, institutional energy on that rather than where we can have an effect, a huge effect. And I said, are we religious enough? Who gets to decide? Well, it should be clear by now that who gets to decide are the courts and the government. They're the ones coming up with these rules. We are. We can lobby. We can litigate. But in the final analysis, the court, and we should lobby, and we should litigate, and we should do all that. Don't get me wrong. But the courts and the political system is going to determine these tests, and hopefully they go our way. The second question I said, what is our mission, and who gets to decide that? That's us. And how we advance it is our, we should be accountable for that, and we should own that. And so, when I became president, I thought, obviously, more than a little bit about this. And I came to the following realization, and so far, after almost 3 years, it turns out to be true.